nothing left to prove. There's nothing left to prove. He freely gave it to us. Sufficient for me. Why do I talk myself out of seeing miracles? You are more than able.
Mosaics are curious things, bits and pieces of stone and glass that on their own may be interesting, but only for a moment or so. Yet together, those pieces form images that move us in unexpected and profound ways.
From the simplest forms to the most complex, it is the combined effect of the tiles arranged in their diversity that brings about something much greater than the sum of their parts.
We call ourselves Mosaic because it describes our unique story as a church and the story we find ourselves in as Christians.
We are part of a mosaic, a patchwork of people,
places,
times, and culture
that depict one person,
Jesus Christ.
Our relationship with Jesus defines everything that we do.
We are faith-filled people with big dreams, and we'll take risks for the future because we believe small thinking is not consistent with a God-sized future.
We are not spiritual consumers, we are spiritual contributors.
The church does not exist for us. We are the church, and we exist for the world.
At Mosaic, we do not deal in hatred and division. Just the opposite. We foster love and unity.
We believe that in the kingdom of God, there is a place for everyone.
And it is our mission to live in a way that communicates that to the world. We will do anything short of sin to reach people with the love of Jesus.
To reach people no one else is reaching. We're willing to do things no one else is doing. That's why our mission is to make disciples by being disciples.
We do this in very practical ways. We bless others, we eat and play together, we learn Jesus through Scripture, and we listen to the Holy Spirit.
On our own, we're little more than bits of stone and glass. Together, we are the body of Christ.
There are some things that are common to all of us.
We want to be loved.
We want to belong.
We want to make a difference in the world.
And we want to be seen for who we truly are, rather than where we're from,
what we look like, how much money we make,
or what we do for a living.
If that is what you're looking for, Mosaic Church is the place for you.
And we're waiting for you, because we believe our mosaic isn't complete without you.
Good morning, Mosaic. We're really glad you're here. Would you stand and worship with us?
I'm
For the promises you've kept and every need you've met. Lord, I'm so grateful you were with me every step, and I never will forget. 'Cause when I think of how your love has never let me go. Never let me go. You have been so good to me. And God, I can't believe how you love me. What a friend you have been. So good to me. And God,
good to be here with you today, in person and online. I'm Brad, I'm the lead pastor here, and I don't know. It feels like there's something special God has for us. That's the truth every week, but I can almost sense that in a palpable way today. We're going to dismiss our kids, our elementary kids, to go downstairs in just a second. But first, we're going to read their memory verse with them for the month, and then we're going to read the bottom line that they're going to be studying today as well. So the memory verse should be on the screen, and let's encourage our kids. Let's all read this together, okay? Ephesians 2:10. We are God's creation. He created us to belong to Christ Jesus. Now we can do good works. Long ago, God prepared these works for us to do. And this week, the main idea that we're going to be talking with our kids about is that you can use what God gave you to solve problems. And it's really interesting how that lines up with what we're going to be talking about in here this morning as well. So can we say that bottom line with our kids? You can use what God gave you to solve problems. So I'm going to invite Pastor Christina to come up and lead us in the Lord's Prayer, and then the kids will be dismissed and we'll continue.
Go to the Father together. Father, we thank you. We thank you for just being God. We thank you, God, that you are holy, that you are set apart, that you are unlike any other, that no other God, no other thing, no other person, God, can stand beside you, but that you are God all by yourself, and that, God, you are on the throne, you are mighty, you are majestic. Father, we thank you that you are the matchless King. And so because you are the matchless King, we can come before your throne of grace. We can come before you, O God, and give you everything that is on our hearts. We can give you us. So Father, we do that today. We honor you. We bow before you. We worship you, O God, in spirit and in truth, knowing that you are the God who loves us beyond what we can imagine, beyond what we can think, beyond any words that we can say. God, we thank you right now. And Lord, we lift up those that are broken. We lift up those that are in need of healing. We lift up those, God, that are in need of salvation today. Father, we pray, God, that the hope that is in this room, the glory that is in this room, God, as your Holy Spirit fills this place, that, Lord, you would meet them right where they are in their place of need, and that you would heal, that you would set free, that you would deliver, that you would restore. Lord, we thank you for all of these things. We thank you for your word that will go forth today. God, that our hearts would be good ground, good soil, and that we would move from this place today doing exactly what you've instructed us to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, your mercy never fails me. just like you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered.
We're going to get into the Word a little bit. I am amped about this new series. I say that a lot. I think I'm amped about all of them, but this I'm amped more about this one than any of the other ones, all right, to date, okay? So you're going to want to scan the code and take digital notes. There's going to be a point in the service where we're going to ask some really important questions, and I think you're going to want to have that available. But first, I want you to repeat after me while you're doing that. Let's see if you can chew gum and walk at the same time, all right? Two things at once. Say this: I want God to use my life in a way that outlasts me. Oh, that's amazing. It's so cool that you said that, because this series is just for you, right? Okay, so we're totally in sync today. For the next 4 weeks, We're gonna lean into one basic question. It's a question that everybody asks at some point in their life. What is the good work that God wants to do through my life? Why am I here? What is my purpose? Here's another way to put it. How will you specifically, like your name, I'm calling you by your name, how will you specifically be the light of the world? How will you specifically be a repairer of broken walls? So this series is for those of you that believe down deep that God created you for something more. You ever get that nagging feeling that we're created for something more, to do something that matters? Well, I believe, I've been praying that God is going to speak directly to at least some of you over the next few weeks and give you the faith and give you the courage to do something in your life that outlasts you. Now, I can hear the inner voice already. You may not think you're gifted enough or talented enough. Maybe you're just too ordinary, right, to do something great. But I want you to hear me. You are the exact type of person that God loves to use. That story is from the beginning of our scripture all the way to the end. So we're going to look at an ordinary man from the Old Testament that made an extraordinary difference. And his name is Nehemiah. You might have heard of him. There's a book named after him. Now here's the deal about Nehemiah. Nehemiah was not a pastor. He was not a priest. He was not a king. He was not a prophet or a warrior. Nehemiah was just an ordinary guy who heard something one day that completely broke his heart. Now here's what set Nehemiah apart from most of the rest. Nehemiah looked around at what was going on. He took in what he heard, and he came to this conclusion. I cannot stand by and do nothing. Somebody has to do something. It might as well be me. And so you'll see in Nehemiah 2:18, there's this point that it says that he began the good work that God had called him to do. And we're going to back up and see how we got to that point, okay? So Nehemiah was a cupbearer. That was the name of his, that was his title. He was a cupbearer for King Artaxerxes of Persia. Now, that would be comparable to being like a servant or a butler, okay? But the cupbearer's job reveals the most important thing that he had to do. So there's always somebody who wants to overthrow the kingdom, right? I mean, that's just part of history. Well, back then, the best way to do that was to kill the king. And the most unnoticeable way to kill the king would be to try to poison his wine. And so it was the cupbearer's job to taste the wine before the king drank it to be sure it wasn't poisoned. The positive is you don't need to worry about workers' comp on that one, right? I mean, talk about the potential of a bad day at work, right? Nehemiah was a guy who was full of integrity. He was trustworthy, and he was deeply loyal to his king. Now, Nehemiah's having a really ordinary day when he hears something that moves him to this place he had never been before. We've all had an experience like this. You'll resonate with it this morning. We've all heard something that has moved us to a place that we've never quite been before. So here's how the story goes. Nehemiah is the one that's narrating the story, and this is what he says. He says, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that had survived the exile and also about Jerusalem. So Nehemiah's brothers have come to visit him from their homeland, and he asked his brothers, he said, tell me about our people. Like, tell me about our homeland. Well, let me give you some background on all this. About 140 years before this, in 586 BC, the Babylonian Empire invaded the kingdom of Judah and completely destroyed Jerusalem. You might have heard about Solomon's temple. It was gone, wiped away, burned to the ground. The buildings were left in ruins, and the gates of the city that provided protection were burned all the way down. Much of their history and culture was destroyed forever. Everybody they knew was out of a job. And then the Babylonians took the Jewish people captive far away from their home and kept them in bondage for a really long time. And after almost 50 years, about 50,000 Jews were allowed to move back to Jerusalem, and they went home to try and rebuild Jerusalem, try to cultivate the land again, try to build a new future for their people. But they had no resources to build back, and everything just stalled out. And so Nehemiah's brothers are here, and Nehemiah's been a long way away, and he wants to know how his people are doing. And here's what his brother tells him. They said to me, those who survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. Isn't it sad when you call home and you hear that things aren't going so well? It hurts your heart, right? The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire. And Nehemiah, when he hears this, he's heartbroken. Here's the deal, you guys. City walls were a huge deal during that time in history. Huge deal. Without walls and gates, there's no protection from people who would try to attack you. And with no protection, there's no hope. So what do you do when you don't know what to do? I mean, what do you do when you see something or you hear something that breaks your heart and you just feel like, I cannot stand by and do nothing? There are three things in this part of Nehemiah that show us how to discover and to begin the good work that God has for you. And remember, I'm going to say it over and over again. I'm not talking to everybody else. I'm talking to you, each one of you. So when Nehemiah hears about his people, you know what the very first thing he does is? He sits down and he cries. He says, when I heard these things, I sat and I wept. You guys, here's the deal. Whatever it is has to break your own heart first. Okay? Nehemiah was crushed. He's heartbroken. He can't sleep. Now, there's something really important to know about this. When Nehemiah heard about his homeland, he was 1,000 miles away from Jerusalem with no planes, trains, automobiles. He was a long way from home. And in addition to that, he was living the good life, okay? He was eating the king's food. He was watching the same shows the king did on Netflix. And when it's time to be real, you know, he takes a selfie with the king, hashtag blessed to serve. How often are you on the couch scrolling through social media and you see something tragic, urgent, unjust, and you think, oh, that's really bad. Sucks to be them. But they're so far away, and man, what can I do about it all the way over here? I'm going to pray for them. I'm going to pray for them, but I'm not going to let it into my heart. Nehemiah is 1,000 miles from his people who are suffering, and he has two choices when he hears about what's going on. Number one, he can acknowledge the plight of his people, and he can think, hey, that's too bad. What a shame. What a shame. He might even make an emotional post on social media, hashtag pray for Jerusalem. Or he could choose to let the pain in, not just into his head, but into his heart, to the point that it shakes him and gives him an ache deep, deep down in his soul. Well, when Nehemiah heard the news, he sat down. You almost get the sense he couldn't stand. He drops and he breaks down and he cries. And I think an important question right here would be, hey, what's breaking your heart these days? Is anything breaking your heart these days? What is it that burdens you? So we've got I'll be telling stories for the next 4 weeks, but I heard a cool story the other day. We have a relatively new couple in our church, Doug and Kathy Durham, and Doug's a cool guy. You need to get to know him. Kathy is even cooler. And Doug, that's right. You better, right? You better. And Doug was telling me about something that broke his heart. He is an amputee, and he realized that amputees have a hard time getting the prosthetics that they need. I'm probably going to butcher this, but I'm going to tell it as best I remember it. And so that got into his heart, and when he realized how difficult that was, it began to weigh on him. And long story short, and that story will be told in detail, in 2013, the Abled Amputees of America and the Abled Amputees Foundation were founded by Doug. That guy right there, all right? Right there. Applause if you're watching online. He's getting a round of applause, all right? Over 10,000 followers on Facebook all over the world, and here's their mission: to make outpatient physical and occupational therapy possible for amputees needing financial support while promoting wellness in body, mind, and spirit. Here's what Doug realized. He realized there is a need that's not being met. We're doing a great job meeting a lot of needs, but this is a cross-section of people whose needs are not being met, and it broke his heart, and I'm pretty sure that he sat down to pray about that, and God has brought something to life in him. It's really cool. We've got a guy named Dylan. You might have known his mom, Julie Cooper, and Dylan struggled with addiction. And over the past year, Dylan has been very successful. I'm really proud of him, the way that he's dealt with addiction, and now he has started his own AA group here at our church on Thursday nights. And you guys, let me tell you something. When he started, he's like, I just feel like I'm supposed to do it. I just feel it's that thing. You felt it. I just feel like I'm supposed to do it. He said, I don't know how to do it. And I'm like, Dylan, you got this. Let's talk. We talked a little bit. And then he just started meeting with him. I've never been in there with him yet. I feel like I don't want to be looking over his shoulder. And he and his father have started this group. And now it is growing like crazy. And now it's one of the groups that's listed in this area. If you need an AA group, this is a recommended group. It started because of his experience. It broke his heart for other people who had been through what he had been through. And here's what Dylan said. There aren't groups that I'm connecting with here. I cannot sit by and do nothing. I have to do something. Well, what did it cost him? That's probably your first question. It hasn't cost him anything. It cost him some time and passion and energy, right? But God is working through him. Well, when Nehemiah hears this news, he sits down and he breaks down and he cries. What breaks your heart? What is it that burdens you? Let it in. Let it move you. Listen, cry, okay? It's okay to weep over things that ought to be wept over. I don't worry when something moves me to tears. You know what I worry about? Is when something has not moved me to tears in a while. That's when I get concerned. I want my heart to break over what breaks God's heart. In the spring of 2008, I was visiting the Native American Christian Academy. That's a Nazarene mission work in Sun Valley, Arizona. And I was there to plan a youth mission trip with my teens for the summer. The plan was we were going to go and work on that school. They have teams that come in. But let me tell you something, things changed. One day I was there visiting and I had taken the tour and I was sitting at lunch and I overheard one of the workers talking about how bad things were in Nazlini. Never heard of the place. A Navajo community that's deep in the heart of the reservation. And the more I overheard that conversation, the more my heart broke. I'm Brad from South Carolina. I don't know a lot of these stories that I've learned over the past few years. And as I began to hear the plight of the people, my heart broke. And I spoke up and I just said, hey, where is Nazlini? And then I'm like, what are you doing, Brad? What, like, why did you ask that? What are you going to do? I just blurted out, where's Nazlini? I said, I want to go there. It's just me on a site visit in a Ford Taurus. Okay? Well, the lady gave me directions to Nazlini. I had rented a Ford Taurus wagon. Okay? Not just a Ford Taurus, it's a Ford Taurus wagon. That afternoon, I left that school in that Taurus, and I traveled a couple hours so far into the Navajo reservation, there wasn't a Walmart for 2 hours. You know, there wasn't a gas station for 30 miles, and I was running a little low on gas. When I arrived at the intersection where I was supposed to turn toward Nazlini, it became quickly obvious that Dorothy was not in Kansas anymore. So I turned right down this dirt road, and in a Ford Taurus, I began to make my way down a canyon road and then across what seemed to be total wilderness. It was so surreal. I got my camera out and I'm like, nobody's ever going to believe this. And I started taking pictures for people who would find my body. I had to stop one time because an antelope, who was not small, decided to play chicken with me on the dirt road and was not concerned about that Taurus at all. Little old Brad from small town South Carolina, he knew he was out of his element. Y'all, after 12 miles of this, I emerged from that valley into a place that would take my heart captive for the rest of my life. I had no idea that people lived like this in America. Complete poverty. I could see through the walls of many of the houses. People's homes were just beginning to receive running water and electricity in 2008. I arrived at the little Nazarene church in Nazlini. I introduced myself to the pastor. Hey, I'm Brad. I'm from South Carolina. I was over at the Navajo Christian school, and they told me that you needed some help. I come here to help, you know, and the guy's looking at me like, boy, you don't even know. You have no idea what. He told me the story of the poverty and the hopelessness that gripped the Navajo families in Nazlini. He also read me into the true history of that part of the United States. It's the history that never once showed up in questions on a test in South Carolina. And he and I became great friends. And I want to tell you that day for me was absolutely overwhelming. Probably of all the days in my life, I felt the most overwhelmed. I was heartbroken that an entire people would be allowed to live like this inside of U.S. borders. Not just some, I mean an entire people. I learned things school never taught me that God really wanted me to know. And at the end of that very first day, I sat down on the steps of that church in Nazlini, and I looked out over what would become one of my favorite places on earth, and I cried and I cried and I cried until there were no more tears left to cry. It has to break your heart first, okay? And my heart was broken for the Navajo people. First, you sit down to cry. What do you do then? Well, then you kneel to pray. That's the second thing, all right? So Nehemiah says, for some days I mourned and fasted and I prayed before the God of heaven. Listen to me, you guys, if it's big enough to cry about, it is definitely big enough to pray about. You hear me? If it's big enough to cry about, it's big enough to pray about. And in verse 5, he cries out, Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night. Listen to that. Day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. This dude's not sleeping. He's praying constantly for this thing that's breaking his heart. In Nehemiah 1:11, Nehemiah prays and he asks God to help him when he goes to talk to the king. Something's already stirring here. He says, give your servant success by granting him favor in the presence of this man. Now, I want to tell you something. This is the first of 12 prayers that he's going to pray in the book of Nehemiah. And if we know about 12, how many thousands of prayers did this man pray over a lifetime? You're going to learn that Nehemiah was a leadership genius. You're going to learn that this guy, he was a strategist, he studies, he casts vision, he delegates, he is a great leader, and yet every single thing he does is bathed in prayer. With all of his giftings and all of his ability, everything he does is bathed in prayer. How do you turn your light on in the world? It's a good question. How do you begin your good work? What do you do when you cannot take it anymore? Well, you let it into your heart and you sit down and you cry. And then at some point you kneel and you pray. And you pray. And you pray. After that week in Nazlini, I went back home to what I hadn't realized was absolute and total comfort. Over the next weeks, I continued to cry. I would lay on my bed at night and I would cry thinking about this place. And I started to pray and I started to pray more. And you know what? Here's the deal, you guys. I had no idea where to start. I was just barely not a kid anymore from South Carolina that had landed himself in front of an antelope in Arizona. I mean, I had no idea what to do about any of this. But I knew God had broken my heart for these people. So I prayed and I asked God to show me. God, show me the work. Show me the good work that you're moving in me here. I feel it, but I don't know what to do. Help me, help me, help me. And as I prayed, it became clear to me just one thing. We needed to take our teens there to help them, to encourage them, and to learn from them, and to seek possibilities. I didn't even have an answer. I just felt like we needed to take a group out there that summer and encourage them and learn and seek possibilities. And so we planned a youth mission trip for that summer, one that would change my life and so many other people. Last week I was gifted this amazing, it's like a pot of gold in my life. It's this binder letters from people over all the years of ministry. I can't tell you how many people refer to that mission trip, those mission trips. Once your heart's been broken and you've prayed and you've asked for God's guidance, for God's help, there's only one thing left to do. Now, a lot of times, that's where we stop. Our hearts get broken, we pray, right? But the job's not done. There's another thing to do. We have to stand up and we have to act. If we're going to follow Jesus, we have to do something, right? So Nehemiah takes the cup and he goes to visit the king. And the king immediately notices that his heart is heavy because they're friends. They've known each other a long time. And he says to Nehemiah, Nehemiah, what is it that you want? And earlier he says, what's bothering you? I see something's on your mind. What is it that you want? And Nehemiah says, even then, listen to the, in that moment, I prayed to the God of heaven. And then I answered the king. See that? That's amazing. If it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in his sight, let him send me to the city in Judah where my ancestors are buried so I can rebuild it. What? What? A cupbearer says, somebody's got to do it. Send me back to my home city, 1,000 miles away, so I can rebuild that thing. Somebody has to do it. It might as well be me. Please let me go home and rebuild. That first mission trip to Nazlini, it established this relationship of responsibility between me and the people of that church and that community. And one trip became two and three. And even when I moved to San Antonio, we took adults and teens on a trip to Nazlini to continue the work that God had started. And over the years, we've built buildings, we've provided running water and electricity, we've encouraged a whole generation of hopeless kids, we've helped lead people away from alcoholism, we've played games and had fun, and we've prayed with people, and we've helped the church with its own facility because it's the one that's going to stay there and continue when we're not able to be there to do the good work. Y'all, so much good has come of that one conversation in that lunchroom. But the one that really, really changed the way I see myself happened when I met this guy here. His name is Wilmer. So Wilmer lived in a house right beside the church. His life and my life were completely different lives. We became really good friends. He would cry every time I would leave to go back home, and I might have shed a tear or two myself. He would run to meet me the minute he realized I had gotten back into Nazlini. The hopelessness of reservation life had driven Wilmer to alcohol, along with 88% of the Navajo reservation. But through me, God, I didn't do anything great. God just showed up. He showed up and he brought some light into darkness. And let me tell you something. He, Wilmer, brought some light into the areas I couldn't see. Into my darkness. And in Nazlini, I learned about the good work that God has for you and for me, that God can use us to change things we thought were hopeless. So let me get back to the story. This is my favorite thing that's happened of all of them. So Wilmer lived in abject poverty. But each time I would come there, he would bring me, and I forgot it, I left the stuff at home. He would bring me this pottery that he had made. And I'm not talking about, like, I've made pottery before. We're not talking about that, folks. All right? You would not put anything in that. But these are beautiful Navajo pots and just pieces that are amazing. Like, they would stand against most in the world when it comes to art. And he would just give these to me. He said, hey, I made this. I want you to see this. And then he introduced me to his friend who was an artist. And I have a picture. It might creep you out. If you're ever at my house and you go to the restroom downstairs, I just realized it's kind of in your face. And so I might move it. But you go to the restroom and you look here, there's this big Navajo. It's a small restroom. There's this big Navajo painting right there, you know. It could make you forget why you came. Beautiful, though. Beautiful. And he introduced me to his friend who painted that. And I have it hanging on the wall in my house. And then his sister who makes these Navajo rugs and quilts that are better quality than anything you're going to buy well, anywhere that I've seen around here. And y'all, I was amazed. I was amazed at the beauty and the quality that I was looking at. And I asked Wilmer, just naturally, this is first world Brad, hey, so where do you sell these things? And he told me, he said, well, I mean, we're only able to sell really by the roadside. And I'm like, that's not good business. But here's the deal. Bet you didn't know. When the U.S. allowed the Navajo to return to their homeland in 1890, they signed this treaty. They only gave them a portion of their homeland back. It was the worst part, the most impossible to cultivate. And amid all the junk in that treaty, there's a stipulation that land could only be owned by the Navajo Nation. It cannot be owned by an individual. It has to be leased out and renewed every year. And if you can't own your own land, you're certainly not going to risk the investment of building a business on land you might not have next year. Hence the systemic poverty that's been perpetuated for the past 125 years. And what even then was still largely a land-based economy, there's no chance of making a living. This is why, and the fatherlessness issue on the reservation, it's because fathers had to go off reservation to get a job, and they would be gone from their families for weeks, hours away. They're not drinking because they're lazy. They're drinking because they're broken. They're drinking because they miss their fathers. Their fathers are drinking because they're out there working for weeks and weeks and weeks, and they can't get back home to their kids. And the only thing they can do to wash away that memory is drink. And the one thing we have been great to provide that reservation with, and all the other ones, is alcohol. The more I listen to him, the more I remember the day we're sitting out on the back of my rental, and I'm looking at this pot, I'm listening to him tell me how they can't build a business, really. And I wept again, and I prayed, and God began to give me this idea, and it's like, it just came out of nowhere, okay? It was this plan that started to emerge. This isn't going to seem like a big deal to you, which is the point, but it was a big deal to them. So every Navajo community has what's called a chapter house. It's like a usually a double wide that's the seat of government that represents that community to the Navajo Tribal Council. And every chapter house, because it's a government entity of the Navajo Nation, it has wireless internet. And so people do have cell phones, because that's the other thing we've made readily available out there for them, right? And they do have cell phones, and so it's common that people will drive up into the parking lot of the chapter house, and they'll get online there and, you know, mess around with their phones, maybe post some stuff. And while I was praying one day, I realized all Wilmer needs is a laptop. All he needs is a laptop. And you know what? He did not know it. I could not conceive of this. Like, this was the eBay days, right? This was eBay, back in the Stone Age. Wilbur had never heard of eBay. Never. He had no idea. I went home and I told the church, I said, well, take up some money. We're getting a laptop. We're going to take him the money and he's going to get a laptop. And we did. And between that visit and the next, a few years later, Wilmer had not only begun to make money, he would get his laptop, he would go over to the chapter house, he would list his stuff, and people like me who fell in love with that place and had gone back home and were missing it would go online, because I don't want anything, I don't want it made in China, that's not the Navajo reservation, I want it made by them. And they would go online and they'll pay good. And he had not only begun to make money selling his pottery, but his friends were doing the same thing with their art and with their blankets. And that might seem like something small to me and you, but it was a game changer for them. So here's what's exciting. In just a few weeks, I'll be taking Pastor Jacob and possibly a couple others that I'm talking to from our church back to Nazlini, Arizona. I'm really excited. And next summer, Mosaic Church plans to take some adults and teens back to Nazlini to continue the good work that God started 15 years ago. And I'm super excited about it. I'm super excited to introduce you, some of you, to these beautiful people. A lot of good has been done over these years, but there's a lot more to be done. And it all started with God breaking some bald youth pastor's heart in a lunchroom at a school in Arizona. So here's the question for this series. What is your Nazlini? What is your Nazlini? What is your good work? I don't know who this series is going to impact, but I am praying it will impact some of you. Something bothers you. Even if you don't let it all the way in, something bothers you consistently. When you see it, when you hear about it, you can't stop thinking about it. Don't shut that down. Maybe you've kept it at a distance, but during this series, you're going to let it travel from your head to your heart, and you are going to feel that pain, and you are going to let it wreck you. You're finally going to let the burden overwhelm you, and you're going to start by sitting down to ache and cry over that thing. And then you'll just drop onto your knees and you'll start asking God, God, lead me. Guide me toward the good work that you want to do in my life, and this thing you've placed in my heart. And in that process, I promise you, you don't know how it's going to happen now, and there's no way for you to. It's not your plan, right? You couldn't dream it up like God can if you tried. But at some point, God's going to prompt you, and you're going to have the faith to stand to your feet, and you're going to act. You're going to do something. You're going to begin to do your good work. And you might be thinking, who am I? I'm not a pastor. I'm not trained. I'm not skilled. Listen to me. You do not have to be appointed by men to be called by God. God has chosen you, every single one of you. You just have to step into that. You have to trust Him, and you have to act. You have to move. You know what? In 2008, I drove to Nazlini in a car that could barely make it there with no understanding of where I was going and no discernible skills to help. What I did have was a heart that was willing to be broken. That's what I took with me to Nazlini. And God has used that to do things over the years I would have never dreamed that I could be a part of. What breaks your heart? I'm going to invite my kids to come up, and they're going to sing just the chorus of a song that on our second mission trip there, one of my teens came to me and said, have you heard this song? This makes me think of this song. It was a Crowder song. It's called Surely We Can Change. I'm just going to sing the chorus of it, because what I want you to do is sit while they do that. I just want you to reflect. What is breaking your heart? I bet it won't take you long to think. I bet you, even if you've been putting it aside, it won't take you long to realize the thing that really, really touches you. And it could be something that you're like, that's not even like one of those big Christian things. What breaks your heart? Doesn't matter what it is. Like, there's so much that needs to be done in the world. Is it in your school? Is it in your workplace? Is it in your neighborhood? Like, what breaks your heart? Is it trafficking? Atlanta's a big old center for that. Is it homeless? What is it? Is it the inability for refugees to speak English and to read? I mean, what is it that breaks your heart when you think about it? Do you know why that specific thing breaks your heart? Because God chose you for that good work. And we firmly believe that if we don't do the things that God has called us to do, that God calls us to do, they might not get done. And so as we listen to this course that's become so special to me over the years, try to chew gum and walk at the same time. Listen to the words of it. And then answer these questions. These are just the main questions we answer at the end of teaching. So what is God doing? What's God doing right now? What are you doing? What are you supposed to be doing? Are you doing it? What are you going to do about it this morning? Would you pray with me and ask God to break your heart and to help you to see the good work that He has specifically set apart for you? God, we love you. We're going to create space. Space to think and to pray. And my prayer is that you will take what you've already burdened people with and you'll bring new life to it. You'll break hearts. That somebody in this room will realize right now that you've been putting the good work on their heart for a long time. And even if they don't know what to do about it right now, it's okay. If you would just move some of us to the point to where we say, something has to be done, and I'm not going to sit by and do nothing. Surely, surely I can change something. Speak to us in these next couple of minutes as we prepare in a minute to come to your table. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, who was in the beginning, and who is now, and who will be forever.
Expectancy and surely we can change. Surely we can change. Surely we can change something. And where there is pain, let there be grace. Where there is suffering, bring serenity. And for those afraid, help them be free. And where there is misery, bring expectancy. And surely we can change. And surely we can change. Oh, surely we can change some.
Is going to come and lead us. Would you stand with me? We've kind of heard this now. Let's sing through this one more time. The cool thing is that Hannah and Wes have both gone. I've got some phenomenal memories of them in Nazlini as children, making friends, gaining a heart for what God has started in us there. And here's what I'd like for you to do is to commit yourself over the next few weeks to be intentional about this, intentional about keeping your eyes open and seeking what is it that God's putting on your heart? What is it that God's calling you to do? What is it? Who is the person in your life that if you're not Jesus to, there may not be a Jesus to them? Who is it? What is it? Know that your good work is gonna be passed on to your kids and it's gonna spread. When you find it, it's gonna fill you up. And it's going to change the world around you. Can we sing this through one more time, and then I'm going to invite Brandon to lead us in the Lord's Supper.
And where there is pain, let there be grace. And where there is suffering, bring serenity. For those afraid, help them be brave. And where there is misery, bring expectancy. Surely we can change. Surely we can change. Surely we can change something.
Now, I understand that there are limitations that some of us bring to this place of a physical kind. And so not all may be able to heed this invitation, but I invite you as we continue in this moment to stand as a kind of declaration that I will not sit back down, that I'm going somewhere, that I'm on my way. Thanks be to God. The truth about us is that we have not loved God with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. And even so, his body is broken for us, his blood poured out for us so that we may have life to the full. So let us have life to the full. Let us live with imagination. And since our imaginations are fueled by our memories, let us remember right now the life-giving love that we have received. And let us not only remember that this has happened for us, let us remember how it happened. Let us remember who has loved us. Let us remember how they shared themselves with us and laid down their lives for us. Let us remember them now, and let us remember them when we leave this room. In a moment, we will remember that we are loved by Christ and by his church, and we will remember how we are loved. In a moment, we will remember what has been done for us, and we will get up and we will go where we are sent. We will look around us on the way, and we will see that we are not alone. We will walk beside one another and wait for one another until all are fed. May God help us as we follow his lead, as we work together to put our lives in good order, as we participate in the ministry of his church, so that we may become partners with Christ in the work of salvation. Pray with me now. Let us ask God to draw near to us and to guide our footsteps, to bless our work, and to make us partners with Christ. Holy God, we gather at this your table in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who by your Spirit was anointed to preach good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, and set at liberty those who are oppressed. Christ healed the sick, fed the hungry, ate with sinners, and established the new covenant for forgiveness of sins. We live in the hope of his coming again. And we remember, dear God, that on the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And we remember that when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so we have gathered as the body of Christ to offer ourselves to you in praise and thanksgiving. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these your gifts. Make them by the power of your Spirit to be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one in Christ, one with each other, and one in the ministry of Christ to all the world, until Christ comes again. Final victory. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. the body of Christ, which is broken for you. May it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. And the blood of Christ, which was shed for you, may it preserve you, keep you blameless unto everlasting life. At this time, let those who are appointed to serve come forward and receive these elements. Having now prepared our hearts before the Lord, come and let us receive these gifts.
Thank you. what the Lord can do. Anything is possible. Anything is possible. Anything is possible. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? To deny what the Lord can do. You are more than able. You are more than what the Lord can do. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? I've come a long way. I've seen how you work. There's so much goodness and I know who I am, and I can't stay where I'm at. We've come this far by faith, and I just can't turn back. He's not done with me yet. He's not done with me yet. There's so much more to this story. You're not done with me yet. You're not done with me yet. You're not done with me yet. There's so much more to this story. You're not done with me yet. You're not done with me yet. No, no. You're not done with me yet. There's so much more to this story. You're not done with me.
Who am I to deny what the Lord can do?
like there's anything else to say after that, does it? But I do have some announcements. This Saturday, 6:30 at Lilburn Park is Rock the Park, a concert. Bring your lawn chair and enjoy that. And then next Sunday, parents, is Family Sunday. And on September 10th, we are going to have a gathering meal. We'll have more details about that, but start looking through your recipes and think about what you want to bring. And just a reminder that our classes have started at 11:30 will be our small groups that meet today. And then there's a class at 7 o'clock on Wednesdays and another class on Thursdays at 7 o'clock. And Tom would like have to say
if
something.
If you spend any time here, you certainly have an appreciation for the talent and the sweet spirit that Hannah Bellamy brings to us in leading worship. When she left for Trevecca 3 years ago, my heart hurt, as did, I'm sure, her family's. But just having her as a part of things up here has been such a blessing. And of course, she got there and they identified that talent really quickly and started convincing her to spend summers touring, and much to my disappointment. So as we headed into this summer, I started having some conversations with Hannah about being an intern here in worship, because I wanted her to be home. And if you don't know, Hannah's a nursing student, so she's going into her senior year. And I thought, I can do a double whammy here. I have a little influence with healthcare. So I thought, I bet I can get her a summer job there too. And so Hannah came home and has been our intern and has been such a blessing and done such an amazing job. Just wanted to thank her. She heads back to Trevecca tomorrow, today? Tomorrow, today. Okay, tomorrow. We're keeping her on the payroll at the hospital, so she'll be home periodically. And looking forward to having you home next summer. That's non-negotiable. We just have a little something we wanted to say thank you with.
I invite you to hold out your hands as we say our closing benediction. May the beauty of God be reflected in our eyes, the love of God be reflected in our hands, the wisdom of God be reflected in our words, and the knowledge of God flow from our hearts, that everyone around us might see and believe. Amen. You are dismissed.